really like to thank Lonnie for bringing his friends out from CBS to come out and support us. And I'd like you to also know that Lonnie has also agreed to join our board of directors here in New York. And Lonnie, thank you for that introduction. And to Doris, I'm going to read this because I probably will mess this up, so it's good that I have these notes. Doris, you have been a visionary, and you believed in hope back in 1955 for those with cystic fibrosis when they said there was no hope. And when my son was diagnosed in 1991, there was hope. I had hope because of you. From the bottom of my heart, thank you for being instrumental in creating the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation that we know today. And to me, you will always be my American idol, hands down. And as Lonnie mentioned, I am dedicated to the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, but I'm really not a volunteer. I'm a mom, like Doris, who believes in hope and will do what I can in my power to see that CF stands for cure found. We are making huge progress in scientific research. When my son Eric was diagnosed with cystic fibrosis back in 1991, the median life expectancy was 19. And today it's 37. 37 reflects tremendous progress, but I'm 42, and the idea of 37 being the median life expectancy, it's unacceptable. And the reality is, we are still losing precious lives to cystic fibrosis way before that very young age of 37. My daughter, Jenna, was 13 when CF took her from me. 13. I wish you all could have met her. She was truly amazing. She was precocious. She was full of life, and she had the personality and the giggle that would steal your heart. Jenna was a great debater, and she was an avid reader. In fact, the last book she was reading was Atlas Shrugged, a book well beyond her years. But Jenna, true to form, was also well beyond her years. She had highlighted a specific sentence out of that book. The sentence I have now taken to be my Jenna motto. The sentence is, pain is not a valid reason for stopping. That sentence alone has pushed me forward when I think I just cannot take another step. I push forward because my son also has cystic fibrosis, and we just cannot afford to stop now. My son Eric is 19. He is a sophomore at Marist College. And I am proud to say that he is doing very well academically and socially. Well, socially, I'm his mom, so I'm just not going there. He wanted to be here tonight, but he's unable to because he is currently at home doing IV antibiotic treatments because his lungs had another flare-up. That means that ever-present CF bacteria starting to take over his lungs is making him cough more, making him mentally and physically tired, and making it harder for him to breathe. To combat this latest flare-up, for 2 to 3 weeks, he requires strong IV antibiotics. In the CF world, we call this a tune-up. We are fortunate to have the best medical care in the country right here in New York. In fact, I believe we have seen the same group of doctors that Doris's daughter Annie has seen over the years. Unfortunately, CF strikes each person differently in different severities, even among siblings. This is Eric's 10th tune-up. I have become so familiar with Westchester Medical Center that I have now called it Club Med. And I know almost every single person that deals with pediatrics. I've been there so often that I now come prepared with these papers. It's to avoid all those questions that are asked of a parent at each hospital admittance. I truly have no idea how anyone can retain that information in their head. So, the type A personality that I am, I have come prepared. This sheet lists 16 medications that Eric takes on a regular basis. The first medication he takes is a pill that helps him digest food. He takes 64 of those pills every day. 64 pills a day from one of his 16 medications. This sheet also lists 4 of his surgeries and 9 prior hospital tune-ups. That also lists the antibiotic, the dosage, and the duration. This sheet is the family and social medical history that they incessantly ask. Sometimes it's just too painful to answer, so I just hand them the sheet and I watch as they read family history. His sister, date of birth, March 13, 1993, was diagnosed with cystic fibrosis, April 25, 1993, due to failure to thrive. Jenna had severe lung difficulties and had been hospitalized 22 times in 13 years. Jenna also had a G-tube placed in her stomach on July 17, 98, when she was 5 because she was unable to gain weight and struggled at 28 pounds for over 1 year. Jenna passed away from cystic fibrosis on December 4, 2006, while awaiting a double lung transplant at the Children's Hospital in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, 6 days after her lungs collapsed. No other family member on either side of the family has ever been diagnosed with cystic fibrosis prior or since. This is a normal part of our lives. This shouldn't be normal. My daughter should be here. And pain is not a valid reason for stopping. I'm not stopping until her dream is realized, when CF does stand for Cure Femme, like Stanley always believes it to be. Because Stanley and Eric and all those still in the fight deserve that. I'd like to leave you with just this one story. It was February 2007, just months after Jenna moved up to heaven, and Mark and I were in DC at a cystic fibrosis conference. We were sitting down, anxiously awaiting to hear Dr. Bell's medical update. We sat right up front. Type A personality, didn't want to miss a word. If you've ever had the opportunity to hear one of Bob's medical presentations, that you would know that he comes well-armed with fabulous props to drive his points home. This year, Bob came out smiling and admitted he had the best props ever. In one hand, he held a white pill. In the other, he had a blue pill. Coincidentally, they were Vertex pills. Just saying. Bob hedged his excitement by saying, "This is going to take a lot of time and a lot of money. But these," he said, holding up even higher, "have the potential to arrest the progression of cystic fibrosis and the potential of controlling CF." At that moment, my heart sank. Now? This couldn't have happened a couple years ago? Now? When they are no use to Jenna? Now? As I sat there with tears streaming down my face, I thought again about what he had said. These have the potential to arrest the progression of cystic fibrosis and the potential of controlling cystic fibrosis. At that moment, my heart soared. I began to comprehend just what he had said of what those two pills could mean for Eric's future and for all those in the fight of their lives. At that moment, 3.5 years ago, was pivotal for me. It was when I recommitted and got back in the fight against cystic fibrosis. It's when I saw the hope that Doris had 55 years ago. It's when I realized that the determination and the dedication of all the folks at the CF Foundation, the CF researchers, all the volunteers and those generous donations that brought us to that moment holding those two pills. The only difference between that moment and right now is time and money. It took a lot of money to implement the various clinical trials that are now looking unbelievably promising. It took time and money to bring that moment in 2007 to this moment tonight. We're not there yet. Time and money are our most valuable commodities, but in this particular arena, money does buy time. We can now have the hope that Doris saw 55 years ago, that money well spent on research can buy more time for those with cystic fibrosis. We need to get those pills and other game-changing treatments in the hands of those with CF. And friends, we need to get there soon. I never want another mother to go through what I went through, where time ran out on her child. I'd like to thank Doris for being the light when there was only darkness. I would like to thank my kids, the one you can see and the one you can't, for being my inspiration. I would like to thank all of you out here tonight for making it here, supporting cystic fibrosis, and buying more time for those with cystic fibrosis. Thank you, and have a nice evening.